አደባባይ ሚዲያ ለወገንተኝነት ጀርባውን የሰጠ ጊዜያዊ ጥቅምን አምቢኝ ብሎ የዘመመን ሊያቀና እውነትና እውቀትን አስከትሎ ኢኮኖሚያዊና መንፈሳዊ መረጃዎችን እንካችሁ ይላል። ትኩስ ዜናዎች፣ ዘጋቢ ፊልሞች፣ ጥልቅ ትንታኔዎች በአደባባይ ሚዲያ ይቀርባሉ። ራዕያችን ጊዜውን ያማከለና ዘመኑን የዋጀ በእውነት የነጠሩ መረጃዎችን በእውቀት ደግፎ ለሀገራችን ብሎም ለዓለም ሕዝብ ማዳረስ ነው። አድራሻችን አደባባይ ኢንፎ ሚዲያ @gmail.com፣ ዌብሳይታችን www.adababai.com። ያግኙን፣ ይርዱን። የሁላችንም ስለሆነች ኢትዮጵያ በአደባባይ እንዘግባለን። አደባባይ ሚዲያ።
አደባባይ ሚዲያ የኔ ነው።
አደባባይ ሚዲያ የኔም ነው።
አደባባይ ሚዲያ የኔ ነው።
አደባባይ ሚዲያ የሁላችንም ነው።
የኛ ቤተሰብ አደባባይ ሚዲያን ይመለከታል። የእናንተስ?
Do your parents watch አደባባይ ሚዲያ?
Watch, follow, subscribe and help አደባባይ። አደባባይ ሚዲያ ለወገንተኝነት ጀርባውን የሰጠ።
Welcome everyone and thank you for watching us, and for those that have celebrated or celebrating, Happy New Year. This is Adawai Media's Viewer Digest program. My name is Hiwa Tadesa and I'll be your host for today. Today we've invited the founder of Habesha Finances, Mark Gebre, to talk to us about financial freedom and financial independence. We invite you to stay with us. Matt created Habesha Finance with a mission to help us get our finances under control, build our wealth, and ultimately achieve financial independence. He's an engineer turned an analyst and now is part-time personal finance blogger and podcaster who is trying to be a voice of reason and encouragement for everyone that is trying to achieve financial independence. In light of this new year, we wanted to talk about how we could plan our lives better, and part of that being our financial health and our financial freedom and getting out of debt and accumulating wealth as well. Matt is here to talk to us about all of this and his journey as well into financial freedom. Thank you so much, Matt, for being here with us, and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you too, and thank you for having me, Hiwa. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Of course. I'm happy to have you here. And let's just jump into our today's conversation. Yeah. Could you tell us a bit about how Habesha Finance came about?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So my first child, I have to credit Abigail. Mm-hmm. After my wife and I, we got married in September 2016. Several months later, we found out that we would be expecting. And so as, you know, new young professionals, I think typical to many of the other professionals coming out of college, we had six figures of debt, a little bit under $300,000. And we didn't really have any, plan to support this new life, financial plan to really support this new life that we were expecting. And so in a way, I had this rude awakening, just something kind of woke up my concern to say, what are we going to do? How are we going to be able to take care of this child? Of course, we're going to love her. Of course, we're going to be there and comfort her. But what about just the future of how she grows up? And so what I found is that the resources that were out there between blogs, podcasts, YouTube, and just in general online, that didn't really share that kind of perspective that that I had and so many of my friends had, where we were first generation Americans. Our parents were immigrants to this country, and God bless them, they worked so hard. They didn't really have the time to really coach us and teach us about investing and saving and do all those things, just really encourage us to go to school and try to get a good education. And so that first generation American experience was kind of lacking in terms of the education on how to navigate through life financially. And so I kept researching more and more, diving deeper. Just as soon as we found out my first child would, my wife was pregnant with our first child. And so I began to dive deeper into all things personal finance. And It wasn't long after that Habesha Finance came about because I just started writing these ideas, taking notes on things that we were starting to do. And then I just put that on a website and I just called it Habesha Finance because I took who I am as an Habesha and joined that together with this passion of mine of personal finance and just in general, financial independence, financial freedom.
Yeah. I need to touch on it a little bit, but could you tell me why this is important for you?
Absolutely. Absolutely. This is important. I mean, for us, for me, because it's important to break that chain of debt, break the chains of financial strain, right? I think so many of our parents and even even us, first generation Americans, we have dreams to support our parents. We have dreams to support our families back home. But here in the United States of America, at least, and I know in other parts of the diaspora, we get trapped into so much debt. We get trapped into a lot of the financial mistakes that that we see our parents once making, you know, once made. And that kind of trickles into the next generation. And so I think this financial freedom mindset and this education is very important, especially for that first generation where we can set the tone and change the trajectory of how our children and our children's children and future generations will live so that there can be that, you know, support of our families back home financially. And even just as our parents get older, there's going to be a need to support them and take care of them in ways that, you know, we want to dream and we want to support them. And so it's really important because at the end of the day, right, you have to put food on the table. You have to be able to pay for living arrangements. And all of those things don't happen by being lazy or just by not have taking action. And that's part of like this message is we've got to take action. The earlier, the better.
Absolutely. So what is personal finance? If you could quickly summarize that for us.
Yeah. Personal finance. I mean, to me, it's kind of like math. It's like history. It's like biology. It's this subject matter that we really should study. However, we don't like in high school, we don't study much in middle school. I think that's changing a little bit. However, back in my years in high school and grade school, that was not part of our curriculum, you know, and that was a subject matter. I think that can empower us to make the best financial decisions for ourselves and for our families. So when we study that subject matter, we can make those choices financially. That is a big part of our lives.
Yeah. You know, when you mentioned that, I had to think back about like my first experience to what personal finance would be.
Yeah.
And all I was told was pay off your student loans and save money. Mm-hmm. And then once you do that, it's like, okay, that's it. Am I done? Like,
right.
Have I achieved everything that I'm supposed to achieve
What's
financially?
Next?
What's
yep.
next? Exactly. Mm-hmm. And that's my journey as well into, you know, the financial freedom, financial independence as well. Like I did all that and I was like, okay, what's next? You can't continue to tell me to save money. Like, what is the purpose of saving money if I'm always quote unquote going to have it because I have a job that pays me, right? Mm-hmm. So that makes it a bit interesting to look into that as well. What are the main things that we should look into when we're talking about personal finance?
Yeah, when you're talking about personal finance, for me, the main components kind of break down into one's net worth, budgeting, investing, and even a topic of insurance, right? I think these are core principles of personal finance that can help people and families move in the right direction towards financial independence, towards financial freedom, and ultimately, it's just securing that financial stability in the future. So I would say, you know, some of the main things is looking at your net worth. I have a lot of friends who make a lot, you know, so much more money than I do. However, when you look at their overall net worth, they're still drowning in so much debt. And so it's great that, you know, people are making, you know, high income or even medium income, middle class, high class, wherever you may fall. But at the end of the day, what is your net worth, right? And then with budgeting, are you keeping track of your money? Are you continuing to understand, like, you know, how to, you know, spend money on XYZ categories, right? You have to have a budget for your food. You have to have a budget for, you know, your lights and, you know, electricity, the mortgage, the rent, and you've got to keep track of that and ensure that, you know, you're bringing enough income to be able to support that lifestyle that you want and also be able to save and invest for the future. And then, as I said, investing in insurance. And I think those are some of the main things that I can just think off, you know, the top of my head is in terms of personal finance.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll dive deeper into these, yep, these topics as well. What are the areas, I guess, we could start evaluating our personal finances as families or as individuals?
Yeah, and it comes back to, I think, the core principles. I think the areas that we can begin is with calculating one's net worth, right? And that involves taking your assets, that is like including like savings accounts, your investment accounts, like a 401k, an IRA, the value of your home. Personally, I would put, you know, just the value of your cars or anything that you would be able to sell if you needed to be able to receive some kind of, you know, a cash for, right? And then also liabilities. That's the stuff that you owe money on, like debt with like student loans, mortgage debt, credit card debt, basically areas where you owe. And I think that is the area that if you're not already on that journey to financial independence, that's where you should begin, because then that kind of starts to paint the picture of in terms of where you need to go and how you need to, you know, achieve like these financial goals. Because like I said before, even though you may have a very good income making $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 a year or so, even more, you know, you may have $200,000 of debt. And if you're just paying the minimum payment on that debt per month, guess what? That debt is really not going away. It's going to continue to be there for the next 30 years or so, you know, until you pay it off. And that's not a place that you want to be in, at least that's in terms of what I have found in the areas of personal finance that I have discovered, is the faster you can become debt free, the faster you can get to financial freedom, financial independence. And I think that's where you, and that involves you starting, us starting with calculating our net worth and then getting into, okay, now I need to start budgeting. Now I need to start investing and saving and doing all of those personal finance related actions.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the things that makes personal finance a bit tricky for people, and including myself, and even the fear of like getting a hold of it, is if you have so much debt, mm-hmm, you feel like you're just in chain, like you said, and it's kind of difficult to say, okay, what do I have? What do I not have? And how do I need to move forward? Mm-hmm. Becomes a really difficult conversation to be had, because if you are in debt, especially student loans these days, if you have a professional degree, you're looking at $80,000, $90,000, $200,000 even. And then it's really difficult to say like, okay, I'll finish paying all that and then accumulate my, you know, my wealth and mm-hmm. be able to be free as far as being independent of that finances. But how do we start that conversation with ourselves as far as getting rid of our debts? What are the means in which we could begin to do that?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think first, you've got to establish that reason for getting out of debt, because when you get to the other side, it's easy to just kind of get back into debt, right? It's easy to just come back into that place that you were in, because the goal is to have a reason why you want to get out of debt in the first place. For us, for me and my wife, it was to make sure our children grew up in a house where they never have to hear about their parents talk about debt, talk about money they owe, you know, the struggles, the financial struggles that I know so many of my first generation friends, you know, it had to see, hear from their parents. And not that it was the fault of their parents. Like I said, our parents had, you know, so little time, because they were working so hard, putting food on the table, trying to make sure that we were going to the good schools and trying to, you know, keep the lights on so we can study and do our homeworks. And now for us, we have this opportunity, especially the first generation Americans and those who are coming to the United States at a young age from, you know, back home. And also even anyone else who's like ready to kind of start this journey. You know, hopefully you don't have debt when you come to this country, right? But if you do find yourself where you are facing hundreds of thousands of dollars in student loan, in just debt in general, consumer debt, you know, you've got to ask yourself why. So I strongly believe that there is an important psychological and emotional desire that needs to develop first. After that, after you define your why, then we can look into strategy. And for that, I highly recommend the debt snowball method for getting out of debt. And basically what this entails is that you would list your smallest debts. I mean, you would list your debts smallest to largest, and then you pay the minimum on all your debts. Okay, once you finish paying off the smallest debt, then you take that amount and you apply it to the next smallest debt, or you add it to the next smallest debt, that monthly payment on the next debt, until you get to the final debt that you have. And you're basically continuing to take all those minimum payments and add to basically creating this big snowball so that you knock it out. Even Harvard, you know, did a study on the different ways of getting out of debt, and they said that this method has been the most efficient, most effective way. I don't want to say efficient, but the most effective way for people to get out of debt, because there is that psychological, emotional component. When you pay off one small debt, you're able to continue and you feel motivated to keep going. There is also the debt avalanche. I know many people would like to talk about that, argue with that, which is fine, you know, and that promotes paying off the highest interest rate first of all your debts. You would pay a little bit extra toward that debt while paying the minimums on all the other debts. And like I said, I'm not a big fan of this. I'm a big fan of the debt snowball method, because you get those easy small wins to help you going, to help you to push you and just encourage you and motivate you so that you can become debt free in a matter of, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, depending on your level of income. Obviously, this is going to take some effort, because for me and my wife, you know, I worked multiple jobs to be able to accomplish that, you know, debt freedom in so little time. It was very important for us to try to increase our income as where we could, right? So I was working a couple jobs here that I was able to on the side, and, you know, in addition to my regular job, like doing valet and whatever I could do so that we could get to be debt free. So it's not just even the debt snowball method, but it is trying to, you know, increase your income wherever you can. And again, you know, this is personal finance, so it's going to be different for everyone. Mm-hmm. Everyone will not have the same income or the ability to work multiple jobs to achieve this. Maybe when they pay off one debt, that will give them some room to be able to focus on other areas of their finances that are, you know, more important. This is why having a plan, defining the reason why you want to get out of debt, is important. And if I may encourage people, try to set a reasonable time to be debt free. For some people, this may be 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, or 7 years. However, if you have if you have student loans that you're saying, I want to pay it off for the next 30 years, believe me, you've got to, take that mindset and change that to try to become debt free as soon as possible. Because, you know, I don't want to, you know, sound too negative, but you don't want to depend on the government to cancel your student loans or do all of these things. Plus, at the end of the day, if you think about it, this is money that we borrowed, right? That I borrowed, that my wife borrowed, that ultimately we, you know, signed that contract, whether it was with, you know, full knowledge or whatnot. We signed that contract to pay off those student loans, right? So I empathize. I sympathize, actually, because we were there. I was there with, you know, our six-figure student loan debt. At the same time, I do think that for people who can be motivated and driven, can take action to try to work towards, you know, paying off that debt. Establish your reason why. I would say embrace the debt snowball method over the debt avalanche method, and then just try to see where you can increase your income wherever you can, whether it's, you know, obviously now with the current pandemic that we're in, it's a little bit difficult to go out and just try to find another job for some people. But when things are a little bit more, safer, and people are able to, then that's when you could explore increasing your income, you know, with the different opportunities that you might have.
Yeah, absolutely. And I like that method as well, even not just on finances, even on day-to-day activities, on time planning as well. Like, I tend to do the easiest thing first thing in the morning, and that way I have that win to build up to the things that I really probably don't want to do. And it's the same idea between, like, when you wake up, make your bed first thing, then you have that first win that you record before, you know, you even had 10 minutes out of your bed. And that kind of gives us the motivation to continue as well. So yeah, thanks for sharing that. Right. Yeah. So what are some of the financial traps that we should avoid when possible?
Yeah, this is an interesting question. Financial traps. I would say first, not managing your money. Right? If you're not budgeting, if you're not keeping track of your money, you're not keeping track of the money coming in and the money going out, right? I think that is a big financial trap that I think all of us can address right away. That's a simple one. I think that many of us can address right away. Like I said, this is your financial future, right? And I like to compare this to, you know, corporations or businesses who have these finance departments, right? Who are keeping track of every single dollar that, you know, this company, XYZ company, is spending. And you have to treat your personal finance with that same level of professionalism, in the sense of you understand how much money you're bringing in and where your money is going out to. And you want to do this with your own life. You want to do this with your personal finance, because guess what? You are very important, right? You yourself, me, my wife, your family, you're just as important. You're more important, right, for yourself than anything else. And you want to be able, and finances is a big part of that. Not just you take care of your health, you take care of your mental health, your physical health. You know, you want to give your children good education. You yourself may have, you know, you've gone to college, you've done those things. The same type of effort, the same kind of effort is going to be needed with your finances, and especially managing that money, getting on a budget. You know, I recommend manually doing a budget. Like, don't connect your budget into a bank account right away, because you want to do this manually. To this day, Hewitt, I will tell you that since 2017 February, I still use the same Google Sheets. It's like Excel spreadsheet where I input our income by hand. I'm not connected to any bank account. Our bank account's not connected to our budget, but I'll go in there and I'll update by month to month, every single month since to the early part of 2017, now going 4 years or so, we've been budgeting month to month. And this has been a big part of our success that we have seen with our finances. And then another financial trap that I'd like to mention is investing in expensive financial products, or putting your money towards expensive financial products. And that's things like whole life insurance. For many of our people, I would say 99% of our people, whole life insurance is something that doesn't really benefit, where you could get a term life insurance product for so much cheaper, and you can take the difference of that money, invest it into, you know, what I'm sure we'll talk about here in a little bit, investing in different kinds of index funds of that kind, to be able to build wealth for the future while securing, you know, in the event a tragedy, like if I die today, you know, if somebody passed away and you had family depending on you, they would be taken care of. You know, I think that kind of insurance, we really don't think of things like that in terms of a necessity. But here in the United States, we have a great resource called life insurance that I think many of our community especially would highly benefit from, especially when you have people who depend on you. And then also, you know, be careful for high fees in finance, in investments that you may be putting your money toward, right? Whether it's in your retirement portfolio, in your retirement plan, your work retirement savings plan, or just a taxable account, check out the fees. Understand what you're being charged to be able to hold those investments. And finally, I want to say about financial traps, be careful of consumer debt. I know we can get into this argument of there's good debt and bad debt. But what I would say is that be careful not to carry a balance, you know, for your credit cards. Be careful not to get into financing a car if you can avoid it, right? If you can avoid it, because I understand some people, to put food on the table, they need to get a car. They're desperate for a car and they have to finance a car to be able to get to work, to earn a living and pay for the roof, you know, pay for the living arrangements for their families, put food on the table. So I'm not totally against that. But I would say if you're able to pay cash for a fully functioning car, you know, it may not be the car that you want, especially to my younger brothers and sisters. You know, I'm in my mid-30s, and to many of you graduating college and getting ready to get out in there in the workforce and whatnot, you know, pay cash for your first car. Don't get into this trap of financing, because you basically delay your opportunity to save and invest as much as you can for the future. And so those are kind of the financial traps, if I can share, just that I would be wary of, be careful for.
Absolutely. And something I noticed is you know, household items that when we need them, it feels like we need them today. So we go get ourselves into debt.
Yeah.
And for me, you know, if you really need that couch, save for it. Like if you need that camera, save for it. And if we get into that, you know, comfortable with that idea of using credit card is bad for the most part, because chances are you will forget, you may not have the money to pay for it 1 month, or, you know, you may not be able to pay for it in full. And chances are that's what that's the case is, because otherwise you would not have spent your credit card anyway.
We recently moved into our first home last year.
Congratulations.
2019. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. But we have slowly, very slowly been buying furniture because we're trying to save up, and we don't want to put anything on a, you know, down payment or finance anything. It's, you know, it's, I don't want to say like it's a burden per se, but I know if my wife could tell you, she'd be like, you know, can we just get all the, you know, get all the furniture. But no, she's mostly responsible for keeping us on the right track and even just monitoring and just making sure we're moving in the right path. And that was a, you know, that's something that we have been very wary of, especially moving into a new home. We get that urge to just fill every room, but with furniture and buy everything. But I think we've been somewhat responsible with that. And I totally understand that.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to quote you here, you say saving money and building wealth requires a lot of patience and a lot of sacrifices. Mm-hmm. And as part of that, can you talk to us about our monthly expenses that we should probably think about living without?
Absolutely. Yeah. The monthly expenses, I think that we have to take a look at. Basically, it's anything that you do not need, right? And the key word is need. You know, to name a few of those expenses that I have found that I have not needed, that I have lived without for the last, I don't even know, I think, and this really actually came from like growing up in that single parent household with my mom, who really was kind of in a way teaching us about money with just making sure that you save and be responsible. But one of the things that we did not have, even as I got in since 2004, 2005, was cable. It was like a $50, $100, $150. I don't know how much people are spending. I see YouTube TV is like $70, and I know that's on the like cheaper side of, you know, cable program that's out there. But I would say, you know, cable is something that is so easy for people, especially in our community, that we can just get rid of. And especially if you have debt, right? Because that $50, $100, $150 that you may have going to cable, you could apply that to your debt. That can help you get out of debt and become debt free, you know, sooner than later. And, you know, in other things like memberships, you know, I don't want to tell people to stop working out. I don't want to tell people to stop exercising, but think about that gym membership or any kind of membership, whether it's like Amazon Prime, you have maybe a Netflix membership, Hulu, you've got Disney Plus, you've got all these different memberships that are out there. And I'm not just limiting it to those. I'm talking about all memberships that you have that are being charged to your accounts on a monthly basis. Beware of those. Beware of those, because if you're not fully utilizing those benefits, you know, that you may be paying for, it might be time to look at canceling some of those memberships. Even buying Starbucks coffee every day. You know, the average Starbucks drink is like $2.75, and so when you calculate that over the period of a month, that's almost $83. $83 per month that I am 100% sure many of my brothers and sisters are spending on their Starbucks coffee that they love. And I'm not telling people, hey, don't go enjoy your Starbucks coffee. Don't go enjoy coffee. Because what I want people to recognize is that opportunity cost. Yes, you're going to go ahead and enjoy your Starbucks coffee, but that $83 per month that you're spending on coffee that you can compound by saving that in like the S&P 500 in an index fund that tracks the S&P 500 here in the United States, that averages about 10% on the high mark, or, you know, 7% if you want to be a little bit more conservative. That's anywhere between $219,000 and $530,000 over the course of 40 years. So that coffee that we drink, or that, you know, meal that we like to go out and eat and spend money on going out every day, imagine how much that's adding up. And I want people to kind of say, you know, saving money and building wealth requires patience and a lot of sacrifice. Yes, patience, because it's going to take time. You know, Rome wasn't built in a day. Saving money dollar by dollar is going to take time, right? The amount of money that that you need to be able to save can be easily, dented, can easily be taken away if you have these expenses that are out there, like fast food or Starbucks or, just memberships, cable television. And I would, you know, with that, I don't want to tell people isolate yourselves from your friends, from society, from community. I love hanging out with my friends. I love spending time with my friends and my families. Obviously, with respect to the current pandemic we are currently in, I think many of us have learned social interaction is vital to our existence. However, you know, when people go broke to fund a lifestyle they want with their friends, that's where the problem is. And I think if we sacrifice those moments or sacrifice, you know, going out, maybe spend that time in and adjusting how we enjoy spending time with one another can really help us, because everything in its own way is related, is all interconnected. The more time we don't spending money, the more we have to be able to invest and save for the future. And it just goes back to, I think what I truly believe is that saving that money and building wealth, trying to build wealth for the future, requires patience and a lot of sacrifice. That I'm sure the more we become more educated and just study and learn from one another, we can get to that.
Absolutely. I think when you're talking about sacrifice, it reminded me of something I heard on one of your podcasts about our environment. And the idea that you brought up, I know when you want to advance, you know, in your career, surround yourself with people that are doing better than you. But even with finances, I find that to be very, very true, as you have mentioned. And it's that idea of if you're around friends that have the same kind of financial goal as you, everything becomes automatically easier. The sacrifices that we're talking about becomes really easy, because instead of going out, we could all get together and cook. Right. And instead of spending really expensive, like, entry fees to anything that we want to do, we can just buy a movie at home and watch it. And that idea has been very instrumental for my growth, I think. And also, I've been open to discussing, like, my financial goals with my friends, with my closest friends. And something I find, maybe this is like our culture, I found that almost all my friends are going through the same kind of like questioning how we're spending money and how we want to save and how we want to invest. But we never really talked about it until I brought up that conversation, right? So now we've learned to kind of, you know, invest together, encourage each other and all that stuff, which, you know, that would have been missing, and we'd have already been doing that independently, which wouldn't have been as powerful, I think. And it definitely is that surround yourself with people that have the same financial goals as you, makes that a bit easier.
Absolutely. You're right.
Well, thank you again. For those of you that are just joining us, we are having a conversation about how to plan our financial future with the founder of Habeshaw Finance, Matt Gebreth. We'll be right back. And please go ahead and like and share this conversation. And we'll see you in a bit. Welcome back again, and thank you for joining us. We're going to continue our conversation about how to better our finances, especially in light of the new year, and maybe take a few assignments that we could take with us to position ourselves in a better place in 2021 than we did in 2020, right? And we got talked a bit about investing, mentioned it a bit. So let's dive into that. Why is investing important? Meaning, when you were talking about that $83 that we're saving per month from not spending on Starbucks, why does it matter in the long run?
This notion that investing is important, I cannot stress it enough, for many reasons. But two, I think, of the biggest reasons are inflation and taxes. You know, things are getting expensive each and every day, right? Every year. And having an investment portfolio with equities, which is another word for stocks, helps, and just in general, helps with overcoming inflation in the future. Because, you know, the cost of school tuition, right, 10 years ago was not as expensive as it is today. And we've been calculating for our children when they get ready to go to college. And, you know, if they don't get a scholarship, well, they're going to have to work very, very hard. And if, obviously, we're going to try our best to save and help, you know, fund as much as we can in 529 plans for our children's education in the future. But inflation is a big part of why investing is important, because investing helps people overcome that inflation. You know, when you're investing in the stock market through a 401k or a 403b or an IRA, that gives people the chance to also reduce taxes that they owe and really take advantage of those tax strategies out there that people use currently to help build wealth, right? Because you can delay the taxes you owe now and help and try to and build tax, you know, invest in stocks and index funds, whatever it is, and be able to let your money grow tax free. And hopefully, you know, by the time you get ready to retire, you're getting ready to take that money out, you're in a much lower tax bracket than when you started saving that money. So that allows you to actually take the money out at a lower tax bracket than you initially were. And we don't know what's going to happen in the future, right? We don't know how tax laws may change. But in essence, I think even the United States government understands that there is a big need to encourage people to put money in retirement accounts and save for the future. There's always concerns with Social Security, whether it's going to be here, how long it's going to be here. Will people be able to get 100% of what they were expecting by the time they get to that age where they're drawing Social Security? And so investing, I cannot stress it again, like I said, is very important. And so for me especially, what I have learned is the earlier you can do it, the earlier you can just start putting $50 away, $100 away into good, solid investments, then the 10 years from now, you will be thanking yourself. 20 years from now, you'll be thanking yourself. 30 years from now, you will just be, I think, in the most, you know, appreciative state where you said, you know what, I'm thankful I was responsible with my money 30 years ago doing what I did.
Absolutely. You know how that we know the saying where money doesn't grow on trees. And for me is, yes, money doesn't grow on trees until you invest it. And it feels like it's money that you forget about because you just kind of put it away.
Right.
And 2 years later, 3 years later, when you go back to look at how much you grow, right? For me, the first thing that shocked me was looking at my 401k account. Knowing that I put very little, like the minimum amount that I needed to put on. And a couple of years later, looking at it and saying, oh, well, if I invested a little bit better, I would have been in a much better position. And also that it grows in a rate that if you put that money in a bank account, it would never grow that as much as well.
Yeah, that's true, Hewitt. That is very, very true. I know people like to say, oh, put your money in a savings account, your bank savings account. Well, you know, you want to be careful with that because you don't, the interest rates that you're getting on those are so, so low. You'll never be able to keep up with inflation and truly build wealth. I understand the sentiment. You want to have a savings fund, and that's okay to put a savings fund, I mean, emergency savings in that kind of savings account. However, an emergency fund in that savings account. However, you really want to be careful with your with keeping all of the money that you're trying to save for the future in that, right? Which I learned, I'm sure you have learned as well, and many of our peers have also learned too.
Absolutely. And I just want to reiterate here when we're talking about not putting, you know, all your money in savings, we're not talking about, you know, empty out your savings, because there's going to be hard times even in the stock market, as we've seen. For me, again, this is because we talked about this is a personal finance. For me is my 6 months expenses, right? I feel comfortable with that number because also my field is a bit more flexible than it might be for most, so I won't be out of a job for more than 3 or 4 months. So I'd be able to cover that, is at least my thinking. And for other people, it might be a year worth for those that have houses. For some people, it might just be a month or two, especially if you have a lot of debts that you need to cover, right? So play around with that. And of course, make sure you have like hard cash at hand for when you need it, but don't put like, you know, 40,000, 50,000 in your savings thinking, you know, I'm doing better for my money, because like you mentioned, inflation, you know, something that costs $1 is not going to cost $1 two, 3 years ago. By then you completely lost the value of that $1 you saved. Right. Mm-hmm. So just, again, personal finance. So play around what you're comfortable with and look up online the different methods or the different reasoning people use for their emergency fund, and follow what works for you.
Yeah. And I mean, when people, and remember, like, I think you hit it on the head, like when you're investing too, you know, it's the mindset, you're investing for the long term. You know, of course, the stock market is volatile, right? In it can feel unstable in so many ways. Like you mentioned this year, seeing the stock market drop, like I saw my portfolio drop 30%, maybe a little bit more. And for people who are watching, what does that mean? So let's just say I had like $100,000 in my retirement portfolio. It went down to $70,000. It dropped. And so many times people get into this kind of emotional response where they want to, they see their money drop down so below and they want to take their money out and put it in like a money market fund or something that they feel is safe. But the problem with that is they've sold their shares at a much lower cost than what they currently had it at that $100,000. So if they do that, that's when they lose that $30,000. It's important. You know, you've got to ride the roller coaster of that up and down, up and down, up and down. I love what one of the financial gurus in the personal finance space, Dave Ramsey, says. You know, the only people who get hurt on a roller coaster are the people who get off, right? And it's the people who, like in this sense of investing, when you're experiencing those ups and downs of the stock market, stick to your strategy, stick to your investment strategy. For me, I have my own personal strategy, right? And for you, you may have your own personal strategy that you have, you know, developed and detailed so many times, gone over so many times. And it's good to just go back to that. And then, like you said, kind of like, you know, try to, for me, I want to say ignore kind of what's happening, right? Because we're not living day to day with our finances. We're investments. We're living for the long term, 30 years from now, 40 years from now. That's where I think people, we should really put the focus on and you know, just not making those regrettable choices when the stock market drops 10% or 5%, 15%, 30% in my case. And then I think you'll just be, you know, because it happens so many times. And I hate to see when people experience this. And if it's too emotional, well, that may mean maybe you're not ready to start investing in the stock market. Maybe you should just keep it in like a high yield savings account, or put your money into CD, certificates of deposits, where, you know, you don't have to be worried so much. But I still encourage people, like, try to have a little bit, you know, of what they have invested in, you know, the stock market, invested in equities. I'm not, and hopefully I get it. Yeah, I'd like to talk to you about, like, you know, what kind of investments, right? I'm sure that's something that would be of interest, or at least, you know, would be something to talk about.
Absolutely. And also another thing to add on this conversation, I think in my lifetime, the stock market crash I remember was a 2008 one. Mm-hmm. And when I was studying, I was in a school at the time, so it didn't really affect me. But mm-hmm. when I was studying it back, what I found is the only people that lost money were, like you said, the ones that took out their money from the stock market. Mm-hmm. And the longest recession within the stock market in the U.S. stock market history, mm-hmm. I believe, is 18 months. After that, it bounces back. Mm-hmm. So as long as you know, hands off, don't touch your money, be patient, and make sure that you have enough money within your savings account for your emergency fund to be able to keep that money where it is and don't touch your investments, then I think you'll be absolutely on the safer side of it than if you had taken it out, like you said, when things went bad.
Yeah, market timing is not a good friend of any beginner investor, or just even me, for someone who's been doing this for 11 years. I am not the person who is going to do market timing. Timing when the market's going to go down, when the market's going to go back up, and taking my money in and out based on that. That's not something I definitely do not encourage.
Yep. And that's mm-hmm. that's when the volatility of the stock market comes to play. Right?
Mm-hmm, exactly. Yeah.
So let's talk about investments. In that sense, when we're thinking about investing, we hear a lot of buzzwords, right? There's investments and mutual funds and stocks and bonds and options and all the other words. Mm-hmm. Where do we start?
For starting, I like low-cost, broad-based index funds or their ETF, exchange-traded fund equivalents. And more specifically, if for anyone who's ever followed the Habesha Finance website, then you would already know this, but I love and like the U.S. Total Stock Market Index Fund. And if people have a pen and paper, I had this ready. What this looks like is at Vanguard, this is VTSAX. At Charles Schwab, this is SWTSX. And then at Fidelity, this is FZROX or FSKAX. And what this basically is a combination of all publicly traded companies here in the United States of America bundled into one investment. And so often we hear, oh, we should have invested in Apple. We should have invested in Tesla, or, in Tesla. We should have invested in Facebook when it first started. And I wouldn't say like having single stocks is a bad thing. For me personally, I don't have any single stocks in my portfolio. My portfolio is pretty much built on index funds. Maybe in the future, there will be like a company that I just want to own a share of to be able to vote and, to have those benefits of being a share owner of. However, where people can start is simply with an index fund. And I think that will kind of open up the world of investing to all of you, to anyone who's interested, because you're going to be able to start to see that index fund, and then you're going to see, okay, for every dollar I'm investing in this index fund, this total stock market index fund, 1% is going to Alphabet, which is, most people know that Google, Alphabet's the parent company. Another percent is going to Apple, and then so on and so forth. You start to see, okay, 0.5% is going to Zara or whatever these other companies are here in the U.S. that are publicly traded. I'm sorry, I don't even think Zara is a U.S. company, but all these other companies that are here in the U.S., AT&T and so many others, through over 3,000 companies that each dollar is being invested into. So if there's a new company that goes public, guess what? Your dollar is getting invested into that company through the index fund. And so you'd never have to worry about, oh, I should have invested in this company, or I should have sold this company, or I should have done this, because, you're getting the benefit of having that company in an index fund. Yes, it's not at the same ratio as owning a share of that stock, but where the beauty of owning an index fund like the U.S. Total Stock Market is that when one company does bad, you're not totally invested into that one company. So your investment is not dependent on one company. Instead, it's actually dependent on the complete U.S. stock market. And, what I have read and what I have seen is this is by far kind of one of the better ways to start. One of the better ways to start, because you do get that exposure to so many companies that you can start to read about, learn about, see how they did, and see where your money's invested. And I think that, for me, and I think for anyone who's just kind of starting, if I were to go back, this is where I would start. I would just start with taking, whether it's $10 or $20 or $50, depending on what brokerage firm you use, meaning whatever company you use to invest through, whether it's Fidelity or Vanguard or Charles Schwab, you can, start with X amount of money, and then you can pay, you can contribute $10 a month, $50 a month into that index fund. And that is, I think, one of the best ways to start. And if you want to kind of get deeper, I think one that I think many people would be able to understand is this portfolio called the Boglehead Three Fund Portfolio, which is named after Jack Bogle, the founder of Vanguard. Passed away 2019, actually 2 years ago now, it's 2019. But he was the founder of Vanguard and created the first index fund that so many of us have benefited from today. And what this portfolio, and basically this is a group of investors who call themselves the Bogleheads, and they have their own website, bogleheads.com. And what they do is they kind of just share investment tips. And what they have done is develop this three fund portfolio that pretty much anyone can use. I've used this for family members to help them with their Roth IRA and their other investment portfolios. But basically, you would have a portion of your investment in a domestic stock total market index fund, like the one I just talked about, the US total stock market, an international stock market fund, index fund, and then a bond total market index fund. And then depending on where you are on your investment journey, if you're, you know, obviously earlier in your career, in your investment career, I think you want to be weighted more towards more like equity, stocks, less bonds, less fixed income, because you're trying to build and you can weather through those ups and downs a lot easier than people say, like my parents, right? My parents have bonds in their retirement portfolios because it's important as they near retirement to have a little bit of stability. And that's where bonds and index funds provide that stability. But they do talk about having those three funds, having a total domestic stock total market index fund, international stock total market index fund, and then a bond total market index fund. So whether you just start with that one index fund that I talked about, the US total stock market, or the three fund portfolio, it's called the Boglehead three fund portfolio. You just can Google it and you can read more about it. But that's where I would start. I know there's like all these different buzzwords, stocks, options, bonds, CDs, even cryptocurrency, Bitcoin. We're seeing the news and it's easy to get attracted to those investments. But I think for starting, it's really important to look at like the history of investments, look at the history of what many of our educators, which I'll be happy to share, you know, on this interview with you, some of the people and the resources that I have looked to, that I continue to look to for guidance, you know, and advice. And these are the kinds of investments that they strongly encourage us to look at.
Yeah. You know, when I first decided, you know, let me look at what the stock market is and learn a bit about it. Mm-hmm. I told myself, you know, Robinhood is better than an Instagram.
Yeah.
In a way that, you know, to change my mindset about like, do I have the time to investigate all these things? Yeah. And I think we spend a lot of time on social media, which I love social media. There's nothing wrong with it as long as
right.
it's in management. But mm-hmm. there's a lot to be said about, you just mentioned a lot of information, right? It might right. seem a bit overwhelming, but start with one. Take 30 minutes a day, right. 20 minutes a day. That time you'd have spent on Instagram, that time you'd have spent on Facebook
right.
to see how to go about doing this. And I think one thing, talking with my friends, that first kind of scared them off was they would ask like a lot of personal information. So birth dates, names, some even sure. ask for social security. So definitely make sure you're on the right websites and you're getting through the right information that you need to.
Right.
But at the same time, that is part of the process as well. So don't be deterred by it. Yeah. It's something that I want to see once you start looking into investment. Mm-hmm. So you kind of mentioned a bit about the different profiles that we can look into. But can you just unpack it a bit for us for three different groups? So one group may be the single professionals, right? Mm-hmm. The other group would be the family units. And then the other group, which majority of our community might be part of, is when we don't have a work-sponsored 401k mm-hmm. accounts to look into. What are the things that we could look into for those yes. three different groups?
Yeah, absolutely. I think if you're going to be like a young single professional or you're in your younger years and you have access to an employer sponsored retirement savings plan, like a 401k or a 403b, I would say to just look out for funds that have low fees. Like those index funds are typically going to be available in that plan, that retirement plan, and look for the funds that have low fees. And typically this is going to be your index funds. Right. And, you know, one thing I would say too, that your company is actually obligated, right? Companies that provide 401ks are obligated to provide good investments. And if you have an investment in there with a fee that's going to charge 1% or 2% for you to be able to hold. Charging you 1%, 2% per year. Then your company, you actually can reach out to your HR, reach out to your company and say, hey, you know, I heard on a video interview from this guy named Matt at Habeshaw Finance. I'm just kidding. Don't say that. But you can look it up, that your company should be looking into good investments that you can be able to put your money in so that you can obviously build wealth with. And if you're, you know, the younger you are, like I said, the more I would resist having bonds in my investment portfolio, the more I would be tilted toward equities, the more I'd be tilted toward REITs, real estate investment trusts, the more I would be tilting towards international stocks. I 100% believe bonds have a place in an investment portfolio, but I think that's for the person who's nearing retirement or the person who just can't really stomach the volatility of the stock market, seeing their portfolio drop 30% in any given year. Like you said, a bear market going through that 18 months, can you live with your, you know, portfolio experiencing a drop, you know, for 18 months? And for some people, that's a yes, some people that's a no. So maybe, you know, for those individuals, of course, then you would want to look at bonds, but a fixed income. But generally for single young professionals, I highly encourage, you know, looking at those low cost index funds that are broad based, that's going to give you exposure. Some people's 401ks, you may not have the US total stock market, but you have a access to a very closely related index fund called the S&P 500 index fund. And that's basically an index fund that tracks the S&P 500, which is the top 500, you know, market cap companies in the United States. So you're still going to get exposure to those big companies, those top 500 companies, which is still a great investment to have. I just personally like having that index fund of all the companies, you know, just something to that to say, wow, I own a piece of all the companies here in the United States. That's where I would go for like single young professionals. And then I know with like families, I think there should still be this kind of notion of investing in good growth stock mutual funds, good growth index funds that are low cost and broad based. And then depending on the age of the older members of the family, that's where I would start to look at maybe introducing bond index funds, municipal bonds, you know, treasury bonds, whatever kind of bond index funds that you might be able to get into, whether it's in a retirement plan or a taxable account. Obviously, with a taxable account, you just got to make sure you're aware of the tax laws and that you have to be prepared for, obviously, in case, you know, you're making money or you sell an investment, you have dividends that get paid into your investment, just understanding that. And obviously, that's where like having a financial account, a tax accountant, a financial planner who can help explain a lot of these things in detail would definitely be a great, great investment as well. So families, when you're looking at an investment portfolio, obviously you have a wide range of individuals, but you want to make sure that you're investing for the future. You're making sure that if you're a little bit older in age, that you have those exposure to bonds, you have that exposure to fixed income. And then for kids and stuff, like there are ways that you can actually open a Roth IRA for your child. It's actually interesting. And more that I want to do here in the next year, 2 years for my child, for my children. But as of right now, we have 529 plans, college education savings plans, that right now is going to help them be able to fund their college education. And the great thing about these 529 plans is if your child gets a scholarship, well, you're able to withdraw the money that you put in, and you don't have to pay any penalties on that. I think on the gains, you would just pay like your tax income, a 401k, like a traditional IRA. Essentially, you know, you're paying only on the gains. So, you know, when you look at that, when you look at the opportunities that you have to invest within a family, there's so many different buckets and so many different kind of portfolios that you can have. I think that's where you're definitely going to have a mix of bond index fund, fixed income, and then equity, stocks, international real estate, a little bit of real estate investment trusts. And I'm not talking about buying actual house, but I'm actually talking about buying investments like a stock that is actually a real estate stock. So you're investing into companies that kind of build these portfolios of real estate, and however they do, basically you're getting the benefit of however those companies, real estate companies, are doing. So that's a way to get into in real estate if you're not interested in like buying and flipping homes, kind of like me, somebody not really into like buying and investing and flipping homes, but I am interested in getting into that real estate investment trust where I can do those kinds of things. So just something for families to do that. And then certificates of deposits is another good thing that I think families can benefit from. And to our parents, our brothers and sisters who do not have workplace.
Before you move on, I had a quick question. Are 529s tax exempt accounts?
So depending on your state, they're not exempt on the federal level. So you won't get a deduction on your federal, but on depending on your state, you would. So like here in the state of Georgia, we do get a tax deduction on our contributions to our Georgia 529 plan. Each state has, not each state, but states should offer like a 529 plan that they have. And obviously this is a topic that we can definitely, you know, have a conversation for another day, because it can get complicated where you can invest in another state's 529 plan, and then your child can actually go to a different state where they can use that other state's 529 plan. It can get a little bit tricky, but if you're in a state with a good 529 plan, then hopefully, you know, your state will have a deduction when you file taxes. But when you're investing in that, you're actually investing after tax dollars, and but it is growing tax free. So it is growing tax free. And then any money that you pull out to use for college or school, right now it's actually available for people to use for even educational expenses before college. So in high school and like private schools, public schools, whatever, and you know, fees that you may have for school, you're actually able to use that for that. So and then that money that you take out is a great thing to have for what is it called, that you wouldn't have to pay taxes on. So the money that's growing in that, all of that you pull out, you wouldn't have to pay taxes as long as you're using it for qualified educational expenses.
Awesome. Okay, you could go on to for those that don't have work sponsored.
Yeah, absolutely. And so for those who don't have work sponsored requirements, self-employed people, similar to like my dad, who I always like to use as an example, God bless his soul, because he's always encouraging. He's like, yeah, just talk about me however, it's okay, whatever. But you know, he's a self-employed person. And so for him, he doesn't have a work sponsored, like a 401k. He can't have a 401k, but he can have a Roth IRA. He can have a solo 401k, a SEP IRA. All of these terms, I think, you know, it's hard to get into the definition and how these work, you know, individually. But if you do not have a workplace sponsored retirement plan, or you may be a spouse, you know, of somebody who's working, then you still have access to a spousal IRA that you can fund. And there are opportunities for people to be able to invest outside of, you know, if they have that, if they don't have a traditional W-2 type income, you know, they're a self-employed individual driving, you know, taxi or driving cab, or have their own business, successful business that they have. They can still open a Roth IRA, right? Because hopefully, you know, they're filing taxes. They're at the end of the year, they're getting with their tax accountant and they're filing their taxes. And they're still able to have a Roth IRA. Depending on their health plan, they can have an HSA, a health savings account. And so this is another big thing that I think I want young people to, especially as well as our older generations, to understand. HSA, health savings accounts, is another one of those accounts that I think is a lot more starting to be a little bit more known, not on the level of like 401ks, obviously, but it's starting to become more known, and is a great way for people to be able to put money into to save for health costs and be able to fund, you know, some different, health, you know, expenses in the future. And so just you know, if you don't have that resource, if you don't have access to a 401k or a, you know, 403b or workplace sponsored retirement plan, definitely check out an IRA, definitely check out a solo 401k, definitely check out a SEP IRA, look at an HSA. And then, as always, anyone and everyone can have a taxable account. And this just, you know, anyone can get this kind of account, but you will have to be wary again of taxes. And definitely I encourage people to just spend time with a tax accountant to help explain like how it works. And, because that can be a little bit complicated, especially when you have all this money that you may have made in your taxable account and then you sell it. And then you're like, wait, I owe taxes on, you know, the appreciation of the value, you know, of the stocks of that I owned in this or whatever, you know, investment that you had in that. And that's where you really want to start getting in, because I think that's like the next level. And that's when, if you're really on that level, then you should understand that, okay, I need to talk to a professional. I need to do a lot more reading and understanding, because things can get a little bit, a lot more detailed and tricky if you're not careful.
I know we talked a lot in this topic, but I think the first thing I would tell people is start by the first thing, right? For me, you know, looking at, for example, 401ks, is the first thing was just have a 401k account, have some kind of retirement account. Sure. And once you have that, you know, it could be $5, $10 you're putting into it a month, whatever you feel comfortable starting with. And then once you have that account, you could then learn to open it up and look at where all your investments is going to, right? So that could be the second step. How are they investing your money? Is all your money going to stocks? Is it going to some stocks, some bonds? And then for me, when I first looked at it, I found out there was actually 10% of that money was actually just sitting as cash, right? So just to make sure that, like, the first step is definitely having that account. The second is, you know, making sure that you put some kind of money every month into it. And the third is to be able to go in and say, okay, what does my profile look like? So I could distribute between, you know, whether stocks or bonds or whatever else I'm comfortable with. But saying that, could you tell us a bit about how bonds and stocks are different? And I know you mentioned when you're younger, you should probably want to invest more into stocks. And then when, as you get older, more into bonds, and how that analysis comes to be.
Absolutely. So, you know, with stocks, obviously you're investing in, like, for lack of a better word, like you're investing in companies. Right, you're investing in like Alphabet, Google, AT&T, Berkshire Hathaway, Tesla now, Facebook, all these companies that are here in the United States of America. That's those are like a stock, right? You're getting a piece of a company. You're taking a piece of a company. Bonds obviously are a little bit different, because you know, you can have bonds, corporate bonds, you can have treasury bonds, government bonds. That you're essentially giving them, right, like that money that they're expecting, you're expecting to be paid back, right, after the term of the bond is over, right? So in essence, with bonds, you know, it's a lot, the fluctuation can still happen, right? In the past, there has been times where the bond market has actually overperformed the stock market. But typically the stock market is where you're going to be able to see the most volatility. And with volatility comes the opportunity to increase your investment over the long term. And I think that's why understanding the difference. Personally, I do not have any bonds in my portfolio, my investment portfolio. I'm in my early 30s. And I had, and aside from when I initially got into investing 11 years ago, when I was investing strictly in what they call retirement date funds, which basically, like, if people look at their 401k or go to Fidelity or, you know, these other companies, you can see like retirement date, you know, 2060. And so the investment that you have, that fund that you have, is actually being invested and being adjusted over time with an expected retirement date of 2060. So you may not have, you'll have a little bit of exposure to bonds, fixed cash or, you know, fixed income, but it won't be as much, and it'll start to increase that allocation to bonds over, you know, the next, 40 years, right? The next 30 to 40 years, your bond ratio will start to increase. So the difference to me, if, with a basic way of understanding is, bonds are more of a stable investment. It's not to say that it doesn't ever outperform or underperform stocks, but historically have been more of a stable kind of investment that is, it would be available for people who are just not confident in the US stock market or confident in stocks as well as much. And for people who are nearing that retirement where they can start looking at like a split between, you know, having stocks and bonds like 50-50 or 60-40, where they're able to kind of bring a little bit more stability into their investment portfolio.
Thank you again, everyone, for joining us in this conversation. I hope you're getting a lot of good information and ideas in which you could start implementing some of these topics that we've covered so far. We'll take a quick break and we'll be right back.
Do your parents watch Adawawai Media? Watch, follow, subscribe, and help Adawawai. Adawawai Media, Logan Tanginet, Jarwan Yasata.
Welcome back, everyone. We're having a conversation with Habesha Finance founder, Matt Gebru. We really appreciate his time of coming here and talking to us about his experience as well as his knowledge about how to become financially independent and have that freedom that we all want and need, as far as being able to live a more planned out life as well. Please go ahead and like and share this conversation with your family and friends so we could have a better year of planning our finances this year and learn a few things that are beneficial as well to grow our wealth. Let's talk a little bit more about, I feel like, what's taking over the YouTube personal finance world right now. This idea of, like, you know, financial independence and the whole FIRE movement. Could you tell us a bit about what that is about?
Yes, absolutely. So when I got into blogging about personal finance and money and investing, I didn't even realize that there had been this movement and this whole group of people dedicated to exactly what I had kind of found as I was trying to do my search for understanding about how money works, how investing works. And so this group was basically, this movement was called the Financial Independence Movement. And even on another level, there is this movement called the Financial Independence Retire Early Movement, which is called FIRE. And the acronym FIRE, F-I-R-E. And so the more I started to learn about this, and it's related to financial freedom in a sense. But I think if you ask people, they don't like to make it synonymous or make it, you know, one for another. It's, financial independence is a little bit of a different movement. And it's this idea of basically like no longer depending on a job that you may have been working for the last 20 years to support you financially. Like, you've made enough to, and you've saved enough, you've invested enough to ideally live the rest of your life to do the type of work that you want to do, right? Mm-hmm. And in case like you ever had to leave that work, because some people may actually be in the job that they love doing for the rest of their lives, right? But in the event that that company or whatever the type of work you had to do was no longer there, would you be financially stable for, let's say, 30, 40, 50 years, you know? And that's what financial independence is, to give yourself time of like 30, 40, 50 years to, in case anything drastic happened, right? Anything tragic happened, would you be able to survive and live off of your investments, maybe like side work that you might be doing, for the long term? And the idea of FIRE, this Financial Independence Retire Early movement, is to be financially independent and essentially retire from, you know, work altogether, right? But like, let me back up, because it doesn't exactly mean that you stop working per se. Like, if you ask anybody who's part of this FIRE movement, they're still very much busy doing work and you know, doing what they want to do. And that's the key, doing what they want to do, not necessarily, you know, working at a job that they feel like, oh, you know what, like, is this really my passion? Is this really like what I want to do? Like, if I can leave, like, you, I've always asked myself, wherever I've been, you know, can I do this for free? Right. Yeah. If you're able to answer that with a yes, then I think you know, you're in a special place. But many people, many of us don't have that ability to say yes, especially when we're in our 20s or our 30s, you know, our 40s. It's hard for so many of us to answer that question with a yes. So financial independence, retire early does not mean that you stop working or earning a living. You have just given yourself options to not to have to work if you choose to not be at a job that, you know, all of a sudden kind of turns ugly for you. You know, it doesn't really feel the way it used to for you. And you're able to walk away knowing you have an emergency fund of 2, 3, 4 years saved up. You have an investment portfolio that's able to last you 30 to 40 years of your life. And so that, I think, is at the core of what this financial independence and financial independence and retire early is, this movement. And it really involves like a very disciplined way of saving, budgeting, and investing one's money.
Yeah. So Matt, how do I get there, and how do we help our families get there? Well, I know you have that like financial independence guide for immigrants. How did you put that together, and tell us a little bit about that so we could all kind of participate in this movement?
Yeah, no, to be honest, you know, we're still working to get there ourselves, right? We're still working to get there. Like I said, this journey for us started 4 years ago, like 2016. Five years ago it started. And so for us, what we have learned, you know, getting there, obviously, as we discussed earlier on, it's going to require people to get rid of their debt. You can't be financially free 30 years from now if you still have that student loan debt, if you still have consumer debt that you're piling on, right? Because you ultimately want to be free from that. And the earlier you are free from that, the earlier you can start taking that money that's going to these credit cards and start putting it in investments that's actually going to have interest work for you and not against you, right? We've heard that quote that, you know, compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world, right? And compound interest will either work for you or it will work against you. And the earlier you can get rid of debt, the earlier compound interest can start working for you and not against you. But yeah, one of the and I'll be happy to share this with anyone who's wondering. I wrote this article on my blog, on my habeshafinance.com blog, that was kind of like a financial independence guide for immigrants. After talking to my dad about like his journey coming here into the States, and kind of the things that he was learning to do and growing and taking work here, taking work there. He, you know, with all due respect, he had, you know, he had those opportunities to be able to take a little bit of money, invest it, right? Invest it in a taxable account and just let it sit there and really let it grow, right? Mm-hmm. And it's amazing to see some of the math, see some of the projections that, you know, back in the 80s, had he had that knowledge and foresight to take the money that he had and invest it, whether it was $1, $2, or $3 here, whatever he was able to do per month to start letting that build and build and build, you know, financially he could be in a different place, right? Obviously, we're very happy with where we are. We're thankful and we're blessed to be where we are. But for many people coming here, there is no, you know, you have resources. And so one of the resources that I tried to create is this guide that basically I hope, you know, would help immigrants with their journey to financial independence, financial freedom. And you know, because they do share that same story that my parents had over 30 years ago, coming to a new foreign country with minimal knowledge of how the systems work here, you know, 401k, 403b, IRA, you know, what is all of that? What is all of that? Index funds, low cost index funds. And so in that guide, I talk about life insurance, something that's very important to have, you know, especially when you're here in the United States and you just come here. Like, there's no reason why, you know, any of my brothers and sisters who come to this country in their 30s or 40s, immediate, like right away, you know, obviously they have like the systems and the processes of trying to get acclimated, you know, into the ways of, you know, the United States of America. But if they are able to apply and get a term life insurance policy for 30 years, it's good to do that, especially because I know so many of them have, you know, families or people who they're living with or people who are depending on them. Like I said, that in, if there's anything that happens, they can, that money with that life insurance can go and help them out, right? Help that that family out who is depending on them. And then I talk about budgeting, I talk about investing, debt, and then other personal finance related topics. And so essentially it's more of, I'm hoping, you know, that it continues to develop and grows obviously with more details and more guides, but there's like 9 or 10 steps that people can go on this guide and see how you can jumpstart your journey to financial independence.
Absolutely. And I know for those of you that are interested in looking at this, you can find it on his websites or his podcast as well. He talks about it in quite a bit of detail as far as taking these different steps as well. So how is your financial independence journey going so far? And tell me that and then I'll follow up.
Yeah. So, you know, our journey is continuing. Like I said, we just started in 2017, February 2017. So, like I said, it has been going as well as can be, because when we got married, my wife and I, this was really a big opportunity, I think, that we had to take seriously when it comes to money and finances, especially in a marriage. When you are in a marriage and now you're having to share a bank account with someone, you're having to share a budget with someone, you're having to share expenses with someone, that can sometimes get a little bit challenging, right? And I think it's part of the reason why we see some marriages experience a lot of troubles because of the finances, the money. And what we learned, part of our growth was going through like a marriage counseling kind of class, where one of the topics over 8 weeks was talking about money. And of course, we're not perfect. Of course, we still have our problems, but I'm thankful that, you know, we're on the same page with what we want to do, with where we want to go, how we want to help people, how we want to invest, and what we want to do for ourselves, for our kids. And I think when that understanding that, you know, you're on the same page, and even if you're just a single person and you're kind of, you have a plan, right? You write down your goals financially on your plan, you start to work toward those plans and those goals. But what's funny is even after paying our consumer debt, after we paid it off, like, I'm still very frugal. My wife will tell you, I'm still very frugal. And, like I said, we don't have cable, and I still drive my 2007 Scion TC. So even having been debt-free, like, you know, a couple of years ago, like, we haven't upgraded any vehicles. Our cars are paid off, but we haven't upgraded any vehicles. So we're literally jamming three of our kids into the back of a four-door sedan. It's like, we have twin boys, and every time we put them in there, even though they're not even 2 years old yet, I'm pretty sure they know that it's not comfortable. They know it's not right. They look at us like, why are we not in a bigger car, Dad? Why are we not in a bigger car, Mom? But it's because we're kind of doing that whole financial independence, like taking our time. If we're going to get a car, we're going to save up for it. We're going to be responsible. We're going to continue to do our part with the things we, you know, have our goals with, like budgeting, saving, giving, investing, all of those things. So, you know, it took us a while to get here. But obviously getting rid of our debt a couple of years ago was very important for us. And so now we're just in this, we're in this zone of trying to save, invest, also contribute and help others where we can, you know, with nonprofit organizations, obviously sending money back home to our families. And that's a very important topic too, that I always want to address, is because for people who are here in the United States of America coming from back home, they have that desire to send money back home, right? Which I think is very noble and very important, right? Very honorable. I think it's the thing that my parents grew up doing and are still continuing to do by sending money back home. And it's something that we've embraced, part of our lifestyles, right? And at the same time, I want people to understand that the more you can focus on your personal finance and investing and like saving, the more you can do to help your families like back home. Of course, they need to eat right now. Of course, they need to support themselves in this moment too, right? At the same time, do not neglect your responsibility to save, invest, and budget, and do the things, take the action, right, to manage your money appropriately, right? So you're not living paycheck to paycheck. You're not, you know, spending money here, spending money there where it's not necessary, and really utilizing like each, like understanding each dollar, where each dollar is going, and maximizing where you're sending that money to, whether it's your own investments or back home, and supporting people in those kinds of ways.
Absolutely. I'm curious, has this journey changed your family life in a way that was surprising or unexpected?
You know, so I would say the one unexpected, I think, thing was that like we really got to learn more about each other, my wife and I, in terms of how we handle money. Like, I was impressed, you know, for me, that she actually is a lot better. Like, so what we found out was she is a better saver than I am. I am a better investor than she is. And she'll tell you that. She'll, you know, have no problem saying that. But I mean, she has no desire to like go spend money on, you know, jewelry or things like that. Not saying that's a bad thing. I don't want to say that's a bad thing, but like kind of materialistic things, she doesn't have that desire, right? For me, the one thing that I have a weakness to is like gadgets, right? So I want to have like the latest iPhone, or I want to have like really nice, cool gadgets. But at the same time, like I try to be frugal, so I'm not going to go buy Apple Watch. Instead, I'm going to go buy a $30 knockoff on Amazon, which that works perfectly fine. You know, that's like right here. I don't know if people can see it, but, you know, I wear it here. It works. And I've had it for, you know, several months, many months, almost a year, and it works. It's what I want. It's what I need. It doesn't need to be a $300, $400 watch. But at the same time, like that's kind of one of the things that I have found, is while I may not really be someone who spends money going out or doing this or doing that, like I've noticed that I do have my spending habits around like little tech gadgets, whatnot, you know, that sometimes kind of catches me, and my wife is like, "What, did you spend money on this?" Or, you know, just to kind of check me, right? Because at the end of the day, we do have goals, right? Mm-hmm. And another thing that I want to also mention is we really were surprised by how much we spend on food. So when you calculate like per month, right? So we have a grocery budget for us, for our family, a family of five. And when I calculate how much we spend per month on a family of five, it's about, with like three meals a day, 30 days out of the month, it's about like about $2.50 per meal per person, which is not bad, right? Because if you think about it, if you go out and eat, you're spending $7, $8, depending on where you are. If you're in DC or, you know, New York or wherever, you're spending $10, $15 $20 on one meal. But when we were buying at these, you know, big warehouse stores like a Costco, Sam's Club, we're buying in bulk. That's what I mean. We're buying in bulk, and we're able to really save a lot of money that way. Because yes, when we're going to buy groceries, we may spend like, you know, at one time, like $200 on groceries to help us get through a couple weeks, 3 weeks, you know, of groceries. And when you look at that, you compare that, how much you're spending per person, per meal, like that is, you want that number to be like $2 to $3. And for us, we were way above that in the beginning, but now we've really like honed that down, been more diligent and more purposeful with like how we spend our money on meals. So we're always asking each other like, okay, what do you want to eat this month? What is some things that you want to eat this month? You know, tilapia, beef, whatever, stew or something like that. Dibs, you know, making jeddah here and there. Those kinds of things. So I really think like budgeting and all of that has expanded our understanding and just seeing how each dollar is truly being spent. That was a big thing that changed for us, is just really like understanding that and just saying, you know, it's not that big of a deal. It doesn't hurt us to be able to track our money in that way. And that just gave us a lot more freedom to do the things we want.
Oh, that's amazing. Thanks for sharing. So as we're wrapping this conversation up, are there some books you recommend in the personal finance category, personalities we can follow, podcasts, anything that may be useful for us?
Yeah, absolutely. So I always say this book for getting out of debt, because this is the book that I read that helped my wife and I get out of debt. And obviously, if you know the debt snowball method, you know it. But I think hearing the testimonies of the people who actually use the debt snowball method, seeing where they were, I think there is like a power to hearing other people's testimonies and hearing other people's, you know, stories of how they were able to get through the financial challenges that they were facing. And so the first book that I always recommend to people, I used to have it, I actually gave it away to a friend of mine, but it's Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover. And he gets into investing, he gets into other things like life insurance. So in general, it's a decent book. But there is like another level when it comes to like investing as well, that I encourage people to go check out. And that is a book called The Simple Path to Wealth by J.L. Collins. I actually have it here. It looks like this right here, The Simple Path to Wealth. Yeah. By J.L. Collins. It's a really great book. And I really like this book for anyone who's already like heading down that road to financial independence. They're working on their debt and they're getting closer to being debt free. They're investing. They're doing those things, you know, personal finance wise to get them on that journey. And this is a really good guide for people doing that. And then one book that I just started reading about a week ago, which I really have I don't want to say it's basic, but it's basic tips. It's called, We're Talking Millions, 12 Simple Ways to Supercharge Your Retirement. So it looks like this right here. It's by Paul Merriman and Richard Buck. And I am impressed by this book because they really show you exactly 12 simple ways to help people, you know, supercharge their retirement, really take steps to do the things, take the action to ensure that they're moving in the right direction to secure their financial future for when they retire. I did want to mention too, like, because it just dawned on me, like when people are investing, one of the, you know, there's going to be different philosophies, especially if you have debt. And some of the different people, they talk about different ways, right? Don't invest if you have debt. Invest if you have debt, just make sure that you're taking care of your debt in the next 10 years, something like that. Right. Mm-hmm. The one thing that I would say is if you have a company match, I think, you know, you may be aware of like companies provide a match into people's 401ks or 403bs, then at least it's good to go ahead and take advantage of that company match, especially here in the new year that we're starting. Companies would match 3%, 5%. It's good to do that and at least start to get that money to help you build some wealth. But anything above that, if you have debt, I would focus that, you know, on the debt. But I apologize. I know I get long winded. I just wanted to add that because if I forget, you know, hopefully people will understand. I don't want people to feel like, oh, well, he didn't mention, you know, if I should invest, you know, in a company match versus this versus that. But, yeah. And these books, you know, they talk about these strategies. So really when you're reading these books, you kind of just have to take, what works for you, right? I think in the foundation, the core, we all understand like being debt-free is a good thing. Investing for your future is a good thing. Having life insurance is a good thing. Doing these kinds of simple, actionable personal finance, you know, tasks are good things. And then when you start to talk about optimizing your tax strategies and investing in this fund over this fund, that's where you kind of understand, you know, the literature and the reading will really start to help you make those kinds of detailed decisions.
Thank you so much, Matt, for being here and having this conversation with us.
Thank you for having me.
Of course, if you could tell us like any last words that you want to share with us, where we could find your work. We've been sharing with our viewers as well on your Instagram page and your Twitter, as well as your YouTube. But if there's anything else you want to add, I'll give you the floor.
Thank you. Yeah, essentially, it's Habesha Finance everywhere, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook. We do have a Facebook group, Habesha Finance. My goal is to be a lot more active in it this year and really kind of talk to the group and have like live streams with the group on the Facebook page, Facebook group. So if you're trying to be part of a community, go ahead and check that out. Just have to answer a few questions before you become a member of that group. But Habesha Finance, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and the website as well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Of course. And all our viewers, I hope you all have learned as much as I have. And I hope this year becomes a year where we get control of our finances and grow in that aspect as well. And also, of course, give ourselves the opportunity of not having to work if we don't need to in the next few years, maybe 20, 30 years, we could retire early. One thing I want to add for those that are counting on the retirement money that will come from the government. There was this thing that I read that said, you know, when this retirement plan was put in place, there were 40 people working for one person that was retiring. Right now we're getting to, for every one person retiring, three people are working. So that's not something I would want to count on. I know that Social Security right now is in a lot of debt as well. So there's essentially no money, and all the money that's being paid out is based on what I'm making today, right? So let's make sure that we take care of that as much as possible. And we don't need to be rich to do that. As Matt has been pointing out, there's a lot of YouTube channels as well you could follow, but I definitely recommend Matt's, because I think there's that cultural understanding that you give us, and the understanding of money, the relationship we have as Habesha people, makes it really easy to untangle those different assumptions that we might have about money as well. And I hope this journey becomes as successful to you and everybody else that is watching. And thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.